It's now my pleasure to introduce the chairman of the panel on American Federalism in Theory and Practice. Today's chair is the Honorable John Shadegg. Mr. Shadegg, unlike all too many former members of Congress, has, I dare say, earned the honorable part of his formal title. He did so through 16 years of service in the U.S. House of Representatives, where he was sent by the citizens of the 3rd District of Arizona, which is in Phoenix. What made his congressional service honorable, however, was not its length, although that was impressive, but rather its object, which was constitutionally limited government. In the pursuit of this, he was relentless, and along the way, he brought many of his colleagues along who otherwise might have flagged. Indeed, while upholding his constitutional convictions, Mr. Shadegg rode to several leadership positions within the House, including leading the Republican Study Committee. Having received his undergraduate education at the University of Arizona, where he also earned a law degree, John Shadegg is an Arizonan through and through, a fitting inheritor of the best of Barry Goldwater's legacy. The founding director of the Goldwater Institute for Public Policy, John Shadegg served as Special Assistant Attorney General from 1983 to 1990. Today, Hillsdale College is proud that he serves as Distinguished Fellow with the Kirby Center. Please welcome the Honorable John Shadegg.
Thank you very much, David, and good morning. I want to begin by thanking David for that kind introduction, but also expressing my sincere appreciation to Hillsdale College and the Kirby Center for all the work they do, and for the tone set by Dr. Larry Arnn. He is an inspirational leader, as his remarks this morning indicated. Our topic is American Federalism in Theory and Practice, and I am extremely pleased that we have three very gifted scholars to assist us and to educate us on that very important topic, whom I will introduce in just a few moments. But before I do, let me try to set the stage. If I were to assert that the federal government is taking unprecedented steps to tighten its control over the states and over the lives of every individual American, few in this room would disagree. Indeed, if you look at the reach of the federal government today, it is easy to understand why Patrick Henry, a leading anti-federalist, refused to attend the Constitutional Convention of 1787, declaring he smelt a rat. As anti-federalists like Patrick Henry predicted, the federal government has grown into a leviathan that routinely displaces state governments. The list is too long to even contemplate, but let me cite just a few examples. I'll start with the Safe Water Act amendments of 1986. They directed the various states to enforce a federal prohibition on the use of lead pipes, solder, and flux in any public water system. I would suggest that is hardly the role that the founding fathers envisioned for the federal government. Just the title of much federal legislation is sufficient to make the point. Let me cite a few. An act to regulate certain devices on household refrigerators. The Condominium and Cooperative Conversion Protection and Abuse Relief Act. The Fastener Quality Act. Clearly, buttons apparently are a federal concern. And the one we're all familiar with, the Degradable Plastic Ring Carriers Act. By 2000, Senator Fred Thompson had become so concerned about the federal preemption of the states that he introduced the Federalism Accountability Act, which would have prohibited committee consideration of any bill that would preempt state law until a potential report could be written declaring and describing exactly how that preemption would occur. Justice Sandra Day O'Connor, I believe, summed up the current state of affairs almost perfectly. She said, "The federal government undertakes activities today that would have been unimaginable to the framers in two senses. First, because the framers would not have conceived that any government would conduct such activities. And second, because the framers would not have believed that the federal government, rather than the states, would assume such responsibilities. Of course, the current state of affairs is not what the Founding Fathers intended. I would suggest to you that to preserve liberty, they intended there to be a balance. Under the federal system the Founders envisioned, both sovereign states and a sovereign federal government, a system of dual sovereignty. As Thomas Jefferson wrote in a private letter to one of his colleagues discussing this concept of striking a balance between federal government sovereignty and state sovereignty, he wrote, and I quote, "Let the federal government be entrusted with the defense of the nation and its foreign and federal relations. The states with civil rights, laws, police, and the administration of what the states, of what concerns the states generally." In discussing American theory and practice, I would suggest that returning or restoring dual sovereignty is essential to individual liberty. And I think that's what we'll hear from the scholars that are here today. Indeed, I would suggest that liberated from the constraints of dual sovereignty, the federal government of today is poised to obliterate state sovereignty at the expense of our freedom. Before I introduce our scholars, let me bring a dose of practical politics to this discussion. David didn't mention it, but I was elected in 1994 as a part of the so-called Republican Revolution. We went to Washington, at that time what we thought was a very large class of 73 or 74 freshmen, determined to change Washington. We were committed to undo all of the wrongs of the past. And having grown up at the foot of Barry Goldwater, my father managed his campaign, it was my charge to be as much in the lead of that fight as I possibly could. What I learned in that experience is that this is no mean feat. Indeed, what we are about is a very challenging task, because as history recorded, it can be fairly charged that rather than changing Washington, we allowed Washington to change us. Now, how did that happen? My friend Matt Salmon, a member of that freshman class of 1994, once said that changing the federal government, indeed turning it around, is like trying to turn around an ocean-going freighter in a canal. Sadly, Matt Salmon was all too correct. I will just remind you of some of the stories and some of the personal experiences I had. It so turns out that at one point in my congressional career in the early years, I was on the Budget Committee. I served there with the now governor of Ohio, John Kasich. John Kasich had passed the House budget, which constrained the size of government rather dramatically, and he had sent it to the Senate. The Senate said, "This is ridiculous. We can't possibly pass a budget that's that small or that tight. John, you have to go back and change it." Congressman Kasich said to Senator Domenici over and over and over again, "You don't understand, Senator. I have a crew of freshmen that will not let me change it." Ultimately, Senator Domenici said, "Of course you can get them to change, and if you can't, I will bring one to meet with me." And so he did. John Kasich took me, in an episode I now describe as show and tell, to meet Senator Domenici. We went to Domenici's hideaway office, a gorgeous office, on the first floor of the Senate, looking down Pennsylvania Avenue, a stunning setting for such a meeting, and Senator Domenici charmed me as best he could and told me that it was essential to the nation that we, in fact, pass a significantly larger budget than the House Budget Committee had crafted and that the House freshmen were willing to pass, and wouldn't I be reasonable? A long discussion ensued. The senator became more and more frustrated, and at the end of the discussion, when I refused to move an inch, Congressman Kasich turned to Senator Domenici and said, "See, I told you." But it wasn't easy. My other favorite episode was my effort to get past a bill I called the Enumerated Powers Act. And I think this again illustrates how difficult it is to bring change to the federal government and why some political understanding of where we are in this fight is important. I had run promising to my constituents that if elected to the United States Congress, I would introduce a bill that would require every member of the United States Congress to recite in the first section of that bill the provision of the federal, of the U.S. Constitution, which gave the federal government the authority to act in that area. Now, being a practical politician, I didn't say that if that was a baloney reason or a fake reason, the bill couldn't go forward, which I would like to have written. I simply said, let's make them read the Constitution and recite the provision of the Constitution which gives us, the United States Congress, the authority to act in this area. This was, mind you, 1995. I wrote the bill and introduced it, and nothing happened. After a while, I asked my staff what had to be done next, and they said, well, Congressman, we've asked the Judiciary Committee to do something about it, but they won't schedule a hearing. So I proceeded to set up an appointment. I tried to get an appointment with the then chairman of the Constitution Subcommittee of the Judiciary Committee, but I couldn't get in because I was, after all, a freshman. So I wound up meeting with a staffer. That staffer, the chairman of the committee, was Charles Kennedy of Florida, not a bad conservative himself. The staffer, I think, is a solid conservative herself. But when I met with her, she had a very simple answer. Congressman, if we did this, don't you realize that when many of these acts come up for reauthorization, we could not cite any reasonable authority for the federal government to do this? I paused. I didn't chuckle. I considered chuckling and said precisely my point. The bill never got, in my 16 years in the United States Congress, that bill never got a hearing in the Constitution Subcommittee of the Judiciary Committee or in the Judiciary Committee itself. I am proud to say that one consequence of my deciding to retire from the United States Congress is that John Boehner took up the cause, after several other of my colleagues had done, and indeed it is now a standing rule of the U.S. House that if you seek to introduce a bill and you do not recite a provision of the Constitution that justifies the Congress acting in that area, the clerk of the House, under this rule, will return the bill to you until you insert such a provision. It seems to me... that 16 years was way too long for that tiny little bit of progress. Let me turn to our scholars, because I'm very pleased to have them here, and I think they will enlighten you a great deal. The idea here is that we are going to look at federalism at the founding, federalism today, and federalism of the future. And so I will introduce all three of them at this moment, and then we'll proceed. Dr. Paul Moreno, who will address largely federalism at the founding, is the William and Bernice Grucock Chair in Constitutional History and Associate Professor of History at Hillsdale College. Previously serving as a John M. Olin, Jr. Faculty Fellow in 2001 and a James Madison Fellow at Princeton University. He is currently a Senior Fellow with the Kirby Center and Dean of the Faculty at Hillsdale. Dr. Moreno has published widely and he has also contributed to numerous encyclopedias, including the Heritage Guide to the Constitution. At Hillsdale, Dr. Moreno teaches courses on the Western and American heritage, modern American history, and constitutional history. He earned his BA and MA at the State University of New York at Albany and his PhD in history from the University of Maryland at College Park. Dr. Martha Derthick will discuss largely or focus on federalism today. She is a political scientist and a professor emerita of government at the University of Virginia, where she formerly was the Julia Allen Cooper Professor of Government and Foreign Affairs at the University of Virginia. After earning her BA at Hiram College, she received her MA and PhD in political science from Radcliffe College. In addition to directing the government studies program at the Brookings Institution, she has taught at Dartmouth College, Stanford University, Harvard University, and Boston College. She's the author of numerous books and articles on American government, including American Federalism, Half Full or Half Empty. She is also the author of a book, Policymaking for Social Security, which won the Kammerer Prize for the best public policy book from the American Political Science Association. Dr. Thomas West will focus on the future of federalism. He is a professor of politics at Hillsdale College, currently a director and senior fellow at the Claremont Institute. He served as a lieutenant in the United States Army, a Bradley resident scholar at the Heritage Foundation in 1988 and 1999, a Salvatore visiting scholar at Claremont College from 1990 to 92. His book, which I suspect many of you have read, Vindicating the Founders, Race, Sex, Class, and Justice in the Origin of America, was the winner of the Bag Hot Council's Pollucci Book Award for the best book in American history or politics. Editor for several books, as well as a frequent contributor to the Claremont Review of Books and other publications, he has authored translations of the works of Plato and Aristophanes. He earned his BA at Cornell and his PhD at the Claremont Graduate School. Please welcome our first speaker, Dr. Moreno.
Good morning, everybody. First, I'd like to express my thanks to Hillsdale College and to the Kirby Center. It's a great honor to be asked to participate in their efforts to preserve constitutional government, and Congressman Shadegg for that introduction. I remember it was said that a lot of the Republicans who were elected in 1994 went to Washington saying that it was a cesspool and then discovered that it was a hot tub. Thank you for staying out of the hot tub. I'm going to talk this morning about the original understanding and purpose of federalism. Now, in one sense, federalism is among the oldest ideas in politics. We can say that it is a part of human nature that some matters can be left to the individual, some to the family, some to voluntary associations, some to local governments, and so on, while some require the whole political community to act as one. On the other hand, the Constitution established a distinctly new kind of federalism. Indeed, the advocates of the Constitution, who call themselves Federalists, forever changed the meaning of that term. That's why today we use the term in what would have been the opposite sense in which it was understood in the 18th century. We use it as a synonym for central government power. In 1787, it usually meant decentralized local power. The Federalists were the ones who began to change that in their campaign to describe a government that was really neither or both. It is hard to improve upon the language of Publius, who described the new federalism of the Constitution in the 39th Federalist Paper. The proposed Constitution, therefore, even when tested by the rules laid down by its antagonists, is, in strictness, neither a national nor a federal constitution, but a composition of both. Note here that Publius uses federal to mean the opposite of national. The term would later be used to describe what he calls a composition of both. And this composite republic was the unprecedented thing that the framers created. As Madison put it in an 1831 letter, the government of the United States being a novelty and a compound, we had no technical terms or phrases appropriate to it. And old terms were to be used in new senses, explained by the context or by the facts of the case. Publius goes on to review the five ways in which the Constitution can be judged as either national or federal. In its foundation, he said, it is federal and not national. Now, John Marshall would later dispute this, and it's open to some question, but this is the argument that Publius made at the founding. In the sources from which the ordinary powers of the government are drawn, it is partly federal and partly national. This would be the great compromise that gave us the House of Representatives and the Senate. In the operation of these powers, it is national, not federal. That is to say that this new government will act upon individuals, not upon the states as states. In the extent of those powers, again, it is federal, not national. The new government had enumerated and limited powers. And finally, in the authoritative mode of introducing amendments, it is neither wholly federal nor wholly national. For most of the history of Western political thought, there were only two kinds of government, the city-state and the universal empire. One took liberty to the point of anarchy and fell to the other, which took power to the point of despotism. Federalism meant to balance these conflicting tendencies of liberty and power. Federalism thus provided the answer to a fundamental problem in all of political thought. The problem, as Lincoln stated it, is there in all republics this inherent and fatal weakness? Must the government of necessity be too strong for the liberties of its own people or too weak to maintain its own existence? Again, it is hard to improve upon Publius, who described the new federalism of the Constitution in the 9th Federalist Paper. It's worth noting that most commentators have focused on the 10th Federalist, in which Publius takes on the argument that republican government had to be small, like those of the ancient Greek city-states. This was considered to be the view of the most esteemed political scientist of the day, Montesquieu. But in Federalist 9, Publius was able to use Montesquieu to support the idea of a federal republic. Publius quotes from the first chapter of the ninth book of the first volume of Montesquieu's Spirit of the Laws. "It is very probable," Montesquieu said, "that mankind would have been obliged at length to live constantly under the government of a single person had they not contrived a kind of constitution that has all the internal advantages of a republican together with the external force of a monarchical government, I mean a confederate republic. This form of government is a convention by which several smaller states agree to become members of a larger one. It is a kind of assemblage of societies that constitute a new one, capable of increasing by means of new associations till they arrive to such a degree of power as to be able to provide for the security of the united body. A republic of this kind, able to withstand an external force, may support itself without any internal corruptions. The form of this society prevents all matter of inconveniences. If a single member should attempt to usurp the supreme authority, he could not be supposed to have an equal authority and credit in all the confederate states. Were he to have too great influence over one, this would alarm the rest. Were he to subdue a part, that which would still remain free might oppose him with forces independent of those which he had usurped and overpower him before he could be settled in his usurpation. Should a popular insurrection happen in one of the Confederate states, the others would be able to quell it. Should abuses creep into one part, they are reformed by those that remain sound." This is what we later came to call competitive federalism. "The state may be destroyed on one side and not on the other. The Confederacy may be dissolved, and the Confederates preserve their sovereignty. As this government is composed of small republics, it enjoys the internal happiness of each, and with respect to its external situation, it is possessed by the means of the association of all the advantages of large monarchies." The root of the word federal is the Latin fidus, meaning covenant, compact, or contract, and it's related to the word fides, or trust. Thus, a federation, or what today we would call a confederation, had been a league or treaty among independent sovereigns. Thus, when John Locke discussed what we would call foreign policy, in which the executive power predominates, he called it the federative power. There are many examples of the federal principle in ancient and medieval governments. The founders were aware of these and probably did not give them enough credit as examples, especially the medieval contributors. The first would be ancient Israel. Daniel Eleazar says in his entry on federalism in the Encyclopedia of the Social Sciences that the Israelite political system was probably the first example in recorded history of a union of constituent polities based on a sense of common nationality with national and tribal political institutions and some division of functions between the two, partly formalized by a written constitution. We can say that the first covenant between God and Adam established a federal relationship, a power-sharing arrangement in which Adam was given dominion over the earth in exchange for obedience to one injunction. And we know that this didn't work out, and that God tried again by establishing covenants with and giving the law to the patriarchs, Moses, and the judges. We can also see it when God reluctantly gave the Hebrews a monarch. The 10th chapter of the first book of Judges tells us, "When Samuel had caused all the tribes of Israel to come near, the tribe of Benjamin was taken. When he had caused the tribe of Benjamin to come near, by their clans, the clan of Machri was taken, and Saul, the son of the family of Kish, was taken. And they ran and fetched him thence, and when he stood up among the people, he was higher than any of the people from his shoulders upward. And Samuel said to all the people, 'See ye whom the Lord has chosen, that there is none like him among all the people.' And the people shouted and said, 'God save the king.' Then Samuel told the people the manner of the kingdom, and wrote it up in a book, and laid it before God." One of the elements of Hebrew monarchy that made it limited or constitutional was the sharing of power between central, monarchical, and tribal authority. The united monarchy only lasted about 100 years. After the death of Solomon, the third king, the 10 northern tribes broke away and formed their own kingdom. In any case, the brief and scanty Hebrew political history was consistent with their idea that, since only God is truly sovereign, human government must be limited. In other words, constitutional government is federal government. And later, the colonial Americans, the Puritans of Massachusetts Bay especially, John Winthrop explained this when he distinguished natural liberty, which he likened to license or the liberty of beasts, with federal or covenantal liberty as the basis of real liberty. The ancient Greeks also learned about federalism the hard way. The greatest defect of the system of ancient city-states was their inability to unite against their larger, more powerful imperial enemies. They did it in the Persian Wars, but then fell to fighting among themselves in the Peloponnesian War. This was in large measure what gave democracy a bad name in political science. And the founders hoped that their composite federalism would not only unite the states against foreign powers, but make the states less prone to the democratic excesses of classical democracy. Thus, the new constitution not only added powers to the national government, indeed it created that government, it also removed powers from the states, principally in Article 1, Section 10. After the Peloponnesian War, the Greeks established the Achaean League, which many historians consider the most successful ancient example of federal government. Publius said only, quote, that imperfect monuments remain of this curious political fabric. He did not consider that it contradicted the general lesson of ancient history, which emphatically illustrates the tendency of federal bodies rather to anarchy among the members than to tyranny in the head. Yet, in his rather dismissive discussion of the Greek federations, Publius did not quote Montesquieu's praise of some of them. S. Rufus Davis, in his History of the Idea of Federalism, argues that, in fact, Montesquieu would doubtless have praised the American Articles of Confederation and later condemned the United States Constitution. If the ancient federations were lessons to avoid, Publius was even more disdainful of the medieval examples. He said, though the feudal systems were not strictly speaking confederacies, yet they partook of the nature of that species of association. The personal oaths of fealty and vassalage created a complicated system of overlapping sovereignties. Publius said, this period of European affairs is emphatically styled by historians the times of feudal anarchy. Modern European monarchies arose to put an end to this system of what he called the tyranny of those vassals over their dependents. Nor did Publius think much of the contemporary examples of the United Provinces of the Netherlands or the Venetian Republic. He took an especially dim view of the so-called Holy Roman Empire, calling it, quote, a nerveless body incapable of regulating its own members, insecure against external dangers, and agitated with unceasing fermentations in its own bowels. Unceasing fermentations in its own bowels, and no long-term care insurance either. A very, very dim view of the medieval polity. Here, though, Publius overlooked many of the important medieval contributions to the federal idea. Perhaps the most important was the principle of representation, virtually unknown to the ancient republics. Medieval cities, religious orders, lay confraternities, corporations, guilds, and universities all had significant self-governing powers. The boroughs and universities of England sent representatives to Parliament. But the most obvious example for the American founders was the colonial governments themselves. Most of them began as business corporations chartered by the Crown with self-governing privileges. And the founders complained about the violation of these charter rights in the Declaration of Independence. Also significant was the fact that these colonial corporations established a great deal of autonomy within themselves. The Massachusetts Bay Company, for example, left most of the business of the colony to townships, which were closely connected to the congregationally independent Puritan churches, which were established by covenants along Old Testament lines. And the fundamental unit of these townships was the family, often called the seedbed of the state. 50 families was the threshold to establish a new township with a church and a school. So federalism was right in their own backyards. And it is not surprising that the independent colonies initially jealously guarded the sovereignty of their states, counties, townships, churches, militias, and families. Most of what the Bill of Rights is about is protecting these associations. Thus, the Articles of Confederation did not establish a federal government at all. They established a federation of sovereign governments, but not a federal government. Thus, Publius concluded that a sovereign over sovereigns, a government over governments, a legislature for communities, as contradistinguished from individuals, is a solecism in theory. Thus, the Constitution established a federal government in which the general government, what we would call today the federal government, would provide the security benefits of an imperial state, mostly in foreign affairs, while the state governments could continue to attend to matters of what the founders called internal police. Thus, nearly every part of the Constitution has a federal feature. The most obvious is the Senate, in which the states are represented as states, especially before the 17th Amendment. Less obvious is the House of Representatives, the seats in which are apportioned among the states according to their respective numbers, thereby respecting state lines. The Electoral College involves a substantial federal element. As Publius noted in Federalist 39, the executive power will be derived from a very compound source. The Senate's special functions in confirming presidential appointments, most especially members of the judiciary, and in ratifying treaties gave the states important powers in the shaping of federal administration, and as Locke would have put it, the federative matter of affairs with other countries. Perhaps most important, the amending process is always a federal act. The state legislatures can initiate the process, and they, or state conventions, are always the ones who ratify proposed amendments. And the only unamendable part of the Constitution is that no state can be deprived of its equal suffrage in the Senate without its consent. We can say, as the Supreme Court did in 1869, that the Constitution established an indestructible union composed of indestructible states. Hillsdale College's mission statement says that the college considers itself a trustee of modern man's intellectual and spiritual inheritance from the Judeo-Christian faith and Greco-Roman culture, a heritage finding its clearest expression in the American experiment of self-government under law. As a historian, I often remark that we need to examine this claim critically. It poses a potential problem of seeing Western history as a seamless segue from Jerusalem to Athens to Rome and London to America. Its emphasis on continuity may conceal a number of important disagreements and conflicts along the way. But in the case of American federalism, I think there was actually more continuity than the Constitution's framers confessed to. American federalism may have been unique in that it was the most perfect example of a federal system, and I'm not just saying that as a chauvinist or a patriot, because everyone after 1787 regarded American federalism as the starting point. But it was also a development of ancient and medieval models and improvements. There were perhaps pragmatic reasons for Publius's underestimation of the continuities with ancient and especially medieval models. But I would say that the founders' understanding of federalism had a lot more in common with these earlier models than they let on. Thank you.
I appreciate the invitation to be here, partly because I've been retired from teaching for quite a while, so I really don't often get an opportunity to address a large audience. And I appreciate also the opportunity to get acquainted with Hillsdale. In my experience, liberal arts colleges often struggle to define their missions. Hillsdale clearly knows what its mission is, and I'm pleased to be able to contribute to it in even a modest way. Constitution Day is, of course, an appropriate occasion for taking stock of federalism, one of the institutional features, along with separation of powers, that Madison named in Federalist 51 as securing the rights of the people. Federalism as a system of different governments is, I think, very much alive. You can see a lot of evidence of it. It's secured by a number of constitutional protections, some of which Professor Moreno mentioned. Foremost among these are equal representation of the states in the Senate, which is specially protected against amendment, a guarantee of the territorial integrity of the states, which can't be carved up or consolidated except with the consent of their legislatures and Congress, a crucial role for the states in the process of constitutional amendment, and a provision in Section 1 of the 14th Amendment that all persons born or naturalized in the United States are citizens of the United States and of the state wherein they reside. So in Madison's compound republic, we are all citizens of two governments. But if federalism is alive, is it well? Granting the existence of some constitutional bedrock, is federalism adequately protected in the ordinary functions and processes of government. And I think not. And in these brief remarks, I will use the principal federal law of education, known as No Child Left Behind, to cast doubt on the efficacy of such protections. The Secretary of Education has said that this law is a train wreck. With its testing requirements, which are an unusually deep intrusion into a function, education, that is traditionally state and local, it has wrought havoc in the nation's public schools. About 38,000 of the country's 100,000 public schools fell short of test score targets in 2010, and thus were found to be failing. Secretary Duncan predicted that the number would rise to 80,000 this year. In Florida, 89% of schools failed. Nearly half of Minnesota's schools failed. In Virginia, 128 of the state's 132 school divisions failed, including all of those in Northern Virginia, which are Washington suburbs. Several states have announced that they will ignore the law, while others, less defiant, have announced that they will apply for waivers. Thousands of public school teachers marched on Washington this summer in a four-day protest that was organized by teachers' unions but attracted broader support. Stories of cheating by teachers in order to avoid sanctions under federal law have come from several major cities: Atlanta, the District of Columbia, Philadelphia, and likely represent a more widespread phenomenon. Commanded to be a nation of readers, we are revealed instead to be a nation of cheaters. For years, the law has been ridiculed by teachers in skits and tweets. Who knows the costs in demoralization of the teacher workforce and quite possibly the loss of good teachers who quit or decided not to apply? How is one to explain the passage of so ill-conceived a law by a representative legislature which derives its legitimacy from frequent electoral tests? Madison in The Federalist explained why members of Congress would be locally oriented, and decades of textbooks in American government have advanced that view. If that were true today, Congress could not have passed a law that purported to improve student achievement by threatening to punish the nation's teacher workforce and its school administrators. Idealism and wishful thinking, of course, are part of the explanation. When Congress said in 2001 that all children must achieve proficiency in reading and math by 2014, 2014 seemed a long way off. But a deeper part of the explanation lies in long-term changes in Congress as an institution. Madison thought that in a republic, the legislature would always predominate. It would be the more energetic, even overbearing branch. But this view failed to anticipate the emergence over time of the populist presidency that is on our TV, who is in our TV sets every day, and who is the agenda setter in national policy making and the sponsor of policy proposals that often emerge in grandiose form, as No Child Left Behind did, from the cauldron of presidential election contests. The law was launched on January 23rd, 2001, 3 days after President Bush's inauguration, with a meeting of 500 educators in the East Room of the White House. A grand, thrilling occasion, so it seemed at the time. As Congress has come to defer increasingly to the executive, neither can it escape the ever-swelling swarm of political activists who swim in the Washington Sea. Aspiring to a legislature whose members would be distinguished by wisdom, discernment, and love of country, Madison cannot have envisioned the frenetic, distracted assemblies of our time, which depend on a staff of thousands who are nominally their agents, and beyond the paid staff, more thousands of policy advocates and lobbyists urgently pressing agendas in hearing rooms, corridors, and cable networks. As the political scientist Hugh Hecklow observed some years ago, our laws emerge from issue networks rather than the minds of elected lawmakers, and the networks become ever more dense, more tangled, less transparent, even to members of Congress, let alone to us, the ordinary members of the public. Finally, although members of Congress fly home frequently, conduct town meetings, and maintain district offices in which much constituency service is done, they cannot possibly walk in the shoes of the people who will be affected by what they do in this era of big government that touches every facet of our lives, right down to light bulbs and toilet bowls and other other items mentioned by the congressman. I take the phrase walk in the shoes from an article, Confession of a Cheating Teacher, that was published online in The Notebook, an independent voice for parents, educators, students, and friends of Philadelphia Public Schools in July 2011, and republished in the Marshall Memo, which circulates to paid subscribers in the education community. This article was based on an interview with an English teacher who explained why she helped her students with the tests but didn't feel guilty about it, though she did suffer from extreme stress. She remarked to the interviewer that it can be difficult to understand the decisions made by teachers, administrators, and students in inner city schools in the No Child Left Behind era, quote, without having first walked in their shoes. Realistically, today's member of Congress has little time for walking in the shoes of the many thousands of constituents who will be affected by what the federal government does when that government acknowledges no limits to what it can do. Congress's mistake of 2001 is compounded by an inability to correct it. Although everyone understands that federal education law needs to be amended, Congress is unable to agree on how to do it. In the absence of congressional action, Secretary of Education Duncan is proposing to make corrections through waivers, which carry a risk of dictation to the states through executive discretion. Now, waivers are a relatively recent invention in intergovernmental relations by which controversial or outmoded laws are suspended in part while the federal executive negotiates with state governors over what to put in their place. Waivers were used in the 1980s and 1990s to lay a basis for welfare reform, and they have also been used to give state governments more freedom in the management of Medicaid. I have not thought their use constitutionally inappropriate. In both welfare and Medicaid, they were authorized by law, and after extended intergovernmental negotiation, they culminated in new law that was informed by experience. One, in fact, could argue that they facilitated the function of states as laboratories of experiment. The use of waivers is also authorized by education law. But whether the Department of Education will apply them in a cooperative, experimental, and flexible search for workable policies, or will substitute federal executive coercion for federal legislative coercion, remains to be seen. Our regulations are anticipated imminently. And of course, then there would be a question always of implementation. How will they be applied in the field? I close with advice, in a way echoing Representative Ryan, to keep an eye on the government's use of waivers, which have the potential to metastasize with deeply problematic consequences. Having had what I regard as a benign, relatively uncontroversial origin in intergovernmental relations, where they have facilitated federal government adaptation to differences among the states, waivers threaten to spread and undermine the rule of law. Following the enactment of health care reform, as Representative Ryan said, the Obama administration granted well over 1,000 waivers, I think 1,400 waivers, to labor unions and businesses whose health insurance plans did not meet the requirements of the law. And attentive listeners to the debates among Republican presidential candidates will have heard Mitt Romney say, I've heard this twice, I've heard him promise to suspend the Health Reform Act through the use of waivers as soon as he is elected. This is a truly arresting idea, that a president can unilaterally suspend the law, however mistaken one may think the law to be. I mean, so far, I haven't heard any of Romney's interrogators among journalists or rival candidates ask him where he would get the right to do this.
Morning, I'm happy to be here. Tom West from Hillsdale College. My topic is the future of federalism. From what we've just heard from Professor Derthick, one wonders whether federalism could possibly have a future. After all, No Child Left Behind was passed by President Bush, a Republican, and supported by quite a few Republicans in Congress. We have seen a relentless centralization of political power in Washington over the past 100 years. This centralization seems to proceed in the manner of a ratchet. When Democrats are in office, new federal programs, such as Obamacare, are passed enthusiastically. When Republicans are in office, they either resist the creation of new programs or half-heartedly go along with some expansion of existing ones. Bush gave us not only No Child Left Behind, but also expansion of Medicare drug benefits. Even Reagan, the most conservative president since Coolidge, left office without a single major federal program being repealed. Does this mean that state and local governments will eventually be taken over completely by the federal government? Perhaps it does. But we need to understand better, I think, why federalism is in so much trouble to decide on the question of its future. The most obvious explanation for the problem we're talking about is that for a half century, the federal government has been dominated by liberals, by people, that is, who believe that expansion of federal power is good for America. It is not that Reagan did not try to roll back federal programs. He simply was not in a position to do so. The House of Representatives was firmly in Democratic hands. The Senate was narrowly Republican during Reagan's first 6 years, but the balance of power was held by Democrats supported by liberal Republicans. There has only been one way to change public policy in American history, and that is to win elections with big majorities. Conservatives have not done that. But that raises another question. Why has it been so hard for conservatives to win elections? The answer to that has two parts. First, the people who have become prominent in American politics are those with talent and ambition. Those people usually attend the most prestigious schools, which have been long dominated in the teaching of politics and history by liberals. People who attend these schools, if they adopt the right manners and talk the right way, are eligible to become members of the ruling class. This class is prominent in both political parties. It sets the tone, political tone, in America today. It dominates the news media. It produces and writes the movies and television shows. Conservatives also have trouble winning elections, not just because young people have been co-opted into liberalism by these prestigious universities, but because the American people themselves are not all that conservative. They like Social Security, Medicare, and many other federal programs. They accept, in many ways, the constant intrusion of the federal government into everyday life. But this does not mean things cannot change. After World War II, conservatives made a major comeback in Congress, and a great many federal programs were abolished at that time, a point that is often forgotten. So the ratchet is not absolutely inevitable. The New Deal, it turned out, was not here to stay in every respect. Federal involvement in daily life was, at that time, substantially rolled back. Serious doubts had developed about the Roosevelt approach, which had assumed that every expansion of federal authority is beneficial. Now, some argue that our solution here is to get back to the constitutional text. If only we could do that, we could solve this problem of federalism. Article 1, Section 8 of the Constitution lists the powers of Congress. And as Congressman Shadegg has pointed out, these obviously do not include control over education in the states, local air emission standards, preserving swamps, wetlands, or mandating the purchase of health insurance. The 10th Amendment makes the point completely clear. Powers not delegated by the Constitution to the federal government belong to the states or to the people. Textually speaking, this argument is correct. But practically speaking, there are two problems with this appeal to the constitutional text. First, Americans tend to read the Constitution in light of their personal policy preferences. Congress has no constitutional power over retirement plans, but few Americans are demanding the repeal of Social Security, and few would really welcome that repeal. Second, even if Congress did act within its constitutional bounds, the basic character of governance in America would not change all that much. What I mean is that the decline of federalism is not the cause of the contemporary crisis, but a symptom of the crisis. The root of the problem is the abandonment of the founders' understanding of the purpose of government. That abandonment has led to a transformation of government not only at the federal level, but also in every one of the states. And I want to say something now about the states. If we step back for a moment and ask, why are we here talking about federalism on Constitution Day? The answer is not because we blindly admire and revere the text of this 200-year-old document. It is rather because we see that government today is out of control, intruding into the details of daily life in a thousand ways that are harmful to the public good. That's the point. And we associate federalism, I think rightly, with the older American tradition of limited government. But would the end of federalism, would the end of centralization of government change government's agenda of taking away private freedom in the name of the public good? I don't think it would change it for the following reason. The states today are generally as eager as the federal government is to restrict traditional American liberties. Let me give a few examples. First, eminent domain. Property seizures by local governments have been widely known to the public since the Kelo case a few years ago. The Supreme Court got a lot of criticism when it permitted New Haven, Connecticut to seize Suzette Kelo's home and hand it over to a body that intended to give it to a large drug company. But this criticism was misdirected, I think. Connecticut was the source of the problem, not the Supreme Court. If Connecticut had not taken away Suzette Kelo's home, there never would have been a court case to begin with. These eminent domain seizures have become so common that one scholar counted over 10,000 of them in a recent 7-year period over the United States. Second point, so-called regulatory takings, another huge problem of local government. Here's an example. 30 years ago or so, a number of people bought lots near Lake Tahoe that were zoned for housing. But the homeowners who already lived in that area and who had homes decided they weren't so sure they wanted any new homes built in the area. Their excuse was Lake Tahoe might become muddy if these people were allowed to build their homes. So the state of Nevada and California got together, created a commission to study the question of what would be the impact on Lake Tahoe of future building. 30 years later, the homeowners were still waiting for an answer to that commission study. So they sued. And the case went to the Supreme Court. And the court ruled that if it were to allow, if the Supreme Court were to allow the property owners to sue local government and get compensation for taking their property, that would undermine the entire modern regulatory scheme of property rights throughout the nation. Therefore, the states of Nevada and California are not to be held accountable for this 30-year delay, and they ruled that, in fact, the property of these people had not been taken by the government. A third example is state and local government licensing requirements, constantly interfering with people's right to enter a large number of professions. A recent study discovered that 29% of the total workforce in America is now required by government, mostly local and state government, to hold a license. Mounds of paperwork are typically required. Lengthy, expensive, and arbitrary permitting processes, pointless educational requirements for occupations, or even just outright bans are very common. Ordinary tasks like driving a taxi, braiding hair, building coffins for sale require licensing. And finally, let's think about Obamacare for a moment. Even if it is repealed, nothing prevents the states from having their own versions of mandatory health insurance. The fact that a Republican, Mitt Romney, was responsible for a Massachusetts version of this policy makes the problem perfectly clear. Government at all levels has exceeded its proper bounds for a long time in America. Now, all of this, what I've already gone through, forces us to go deeper. The root of the difficulty is that Americans have been taught for the past century that the founders' understanding of the purpose of government is wrong. And that is why pro-federalism conservatives have not been able to win enough elections. That is why the states are as much of a problem as the feds. That is why our educational system has been so predominantly liberal. I can sum up my talk in this sense, from this point of view, in one sentence. Federalism, in the constitutional sense, will only have a future if we can successfully revive the founders' understanding of what government is for and what policies are needed to get to that goal. This is a task that Hillsdale College has dedicated itself to, and I'm proud to be part of that enterprise. The Declaration of Independence talks about two criteria of just government. One is consent, I'm not talking about that. The other is securing rights. What does it take to secure rights? In the founders' understanding, that primarily meant criminal law and civil law, meaning criminal law punish people who take away your life, liberty, or property, or harm you in that. Civil law meaning provide for definitions of property, clear understanding of who owns what, rules for contracts, and all of the rest, to enable people in their ordinary daily lives to provide for themselves by free exchange with other individuals in society. That's how you secure rights. But government today has a very different view. I'll quote Woodrow Wilson, one of the early liberals. He argued that, quote, "We used to think in the old-fashioned days when life was very simple that all government had to do was put on a policeman's uniform and say, now don't anybody hurt anybody else. We used to say," Wilson said, "that the ideal of government was for every man to be left alone and not interfered with unless he interfered with somebody else. That was the idea that obtained in Jefferson's time," said Wilson. And basically, Wilson is right about that. That was the old ideal. But Wilson goes on to say, that's not possible anymore. And he gives the example, which I think is telling, of the Scottish city of Glasgow, where government installed lights in the corridors of apartment buildings. For Wilson, this is the perfect example of how government needs to act in the conditions of modern society. His assumption was, unless government actually goes into the hallways and puts in the lights, the workers of Glasgow will forever stumble down the corridors in the dark. Wilson seems to have ruled out the possibility that workers living in the dark might decide that they should move to an apartment building that has lights in the hallway. If we apply Wilson's lesson to today, the point is, government cannot trust parents to take proper care of their children, any more than landlords can be trusted to provide proper lighting in hallways. One conclusion might be that government must pay for vaccinations against venereal disease for all 12-year-old girls and make those vaccinations mandatory unless parents specifically opt out. My conclusion is, federalism has a future, to the extent that American liberty as a whole has a future. We've seen in the 2010 election, the people are beginning to rise up against centralization. And we've seen in recent decades a real change in American journalism and American higher education. When I was a grad student, nobody, I'm exaggerating, hardly anybody was making any kind of an argument against the modern state. And there was nothing out there to read in the journalistic world other than National Review and a couple of other things. Now there's so much out there, it's impossible to keep up with it. And a lot of it is really high quality material. The critiques of the modern state and its excesses have gotten better and better. And colleges like Hillsdale have gotten better and better too at developing arguments and understanding the problems that we face today. If we can revive an intelligent defense of free government, and we can restore the conditions for a return of federalism. Thank you very much.
Now, your turn. If you will raise your hand and indicate that you'd like to ask a question, one of the students in the room will get to you with a microphone. It's very important that we don't allow questions until the microphone has reached you, because in part this is being webcast, and the viewers on the webcast need to not only be able to hear you, but also see you. So it's important that you wait to ask your question, and that way we can get both the microphone there and the camera focused. Yes, sir.
The speakers were very eloquent in pointing out what I believe is the fact that our electorate is so abysmally ignorant of the Declaration of Independence, the Constitution, and in fact, in my experience, just plain reading, writing, and arithmetic, that we get convinced that the federal government and our local government is the answer to all our problems. In fact, it scares me that a lot of these folks are allowed to vote and procreate unsupervised. As a starting point, how do all of our speakers feel about just plain abolishing the Department of Education at the federal level as quickly as possible?
Is that a question?
Well, that was one of the proposals that Ronald Reagan made when he got elected. And the difficulty is basically everybody who's in the establishment of the country today is supportive of that kind of thing. It's very difficult to go against it. I agree the case is not there for the Federal Department of Education, but, to go back to my overall point, it seems to me that it's only when the professors of America are able to do a better job of explaining the principles of what government needs to be that we can even get people into the frame of mind of thinking that there's a significant problem with departments like the Department of Education. And that's where I think we need to, go.
This next question comes from our online viewers. Alex asks, why do states, Congress, and the president all look to the courts to decide what the Constitution means? Is this process itself constitutional?
I can't hear.
Oh, the essence was, why do we look, and anyone can, any panelist can choose to answer, why do people in America government officials look to the courts to resolve these questions, and is, in fact, that deference to the courts itself constitutional? Go ahead, Paul.
I think that Dr. Arnn mentioned this morning that Nancy Pelosi's reaction to the question about where was the constitutional basis for Obamacare is a good indication of this. But also, it's a way in which elected officials are able to evade difficult political questions by sort of punting them and handing them over to the courts. Stephen Douglas did this before the Civil War on the slavery question. So it does take some real sort of constitutional or political integrity for elected officials to take on the constitutional questions themselves rather than conveniently they say, well, that's for the courts to decide.
I was just going to add that I think that there's a tendency among some people to look to the courts as the great power, the really important thing that's going to dominate what the federal government will do. It seems to me that what we've learned from American history and also in recent politics is the courts are not anywhere near as powerful as they look. The courts are very reluctant to go very far against whatever the prevailing consensus is in the ruling class of America. And among the people. They'll go after outliers, but not against the mainstream of public opinion. And when they do, they get crushed. So, ultimately, I think the question becomes what sorts of people are going to be in these institutions, in the courts, in the legislative and the executive branches. Their consensus view is what will determine policy.
Professor?
I would also like to add that I think we're affected by a suspicion of bureaucrats, as Congressman Ryan's talk would suggest. We prefer judges to appointed officials. If you compare the United States to other countries, Europe, I'm thinking of Europe in particular, give greater power to experts, to bureaucrats, to appointed officials. We don't really like to do that. We prefer judges to bureaucrats.
Professor Derthick, I'd appreciate if you'd comment about the ramifications of the rise in student loans and the delinquencies, and also the failure of our policy of encouraging many young people to go to college without a vocational track in our school system, and from tenured professors who have an axe to grind at turning out people who aren't able to add much value to society. Thank you.
Yeah, I can't hear. What was the question?
I'll try to summarize it. The questioner would like you to summarize your views of the extensive college loans, the encouragement of so many young people to go to school, go to college, without a career path or without any other alternative other than going to college. And I guess I missed the last of the question, but it was in essence, are we pursuing the correct policy? In
encouraging everyone to go to college? Well, no. At the same time, I appear as a believer, as a product of a small liberal arts college, a believer that liberal arts colleges have a very important value, and I think they do teach people to think critically, to perform important functions as citizens, and I don't think it's altogether beneficial that liberal arts colleges are declining in number and are under great pressure to become vocational schools and to produce advanced curricula that will prepare people for careers. I mean, there's much talk of needing to be career ready. I think it's better to be deeply educated than to be career ready.
Well made.
As probably most of you already know that Hillsdale College doesn't take any federal student loans, so we're sort of not that problem for us. But there is a sense in which I think it's the same process that we see going on with the green jobs and subsidizing these companies that are going to produce things that people otherwise wouldn't want, right? The federal government's going to bail out General Motors and get them to make these electric cars, right? And then they're going to give taxpayers all these subsidies to buy those electric cars, right? And I think you have the same thing going on where the overconsumption of education is being driven on the producer side by federal subsidies to through student loans and other things, supporting important constituencies like teacher unions. It's a way in which federal spending ends up trying to produce a demand for something that there normally wouldn't be a demand for. And thus, the prices of those things accelerate at rates much higher than the rest of the economy.
Next question. It's a microphone.
Good afternoon. Proceed.
Go ahead.
And in the October 2004 Virginia Lawyer magazine, very fine jurist Arthur Kelsey of the Virginia Court of Appeals had an article about the architecture of the federal judiciary. And he said that Jefferson said that should he be forced to make a choice between a vote in the legislative branch or the judicial branch, he would have to choose the judicial branch because it is more important. And rarely are we taught in our constitutional law classes that we actually have two votes in the judicial branch, the grand jury and the trial jury. And indeed, the concept of the Founding Fathers was that we had a bicameral judiciary with judges like the Senate and the jury like the House of Representatives to balance each other. And in Virginia, we have the special grand jury, which is the one non-political body with the authority to investigate and indict government agencies or officials for wrongdoing or failure to uphold the people's will. Do you have any comment in regard to how we might, as conservatives, start to reclaim our government by use of the grand jury process to require that our elected servants, not our elected officials, our elected servants, serve the will of the people?
Comment?
Tom, you mentioned that people often overestimate the impact that the judiciary has as part of our constitutional problems today, and I think that's true. And Jefferson was, I think, one of those people who tended to exaggerate the problem of the power of the judges. As he famously said about the federal judges, they seldom retire and never die, right? I don't know about the grand jury, especially at the state and local level, might be a good prospect. But there are also plenty of devices in the Constitution, as it's already written, in Article 3 especially, that, as I think as Congressman Ryan mentioned, that the tools are there in the Constitution. And there are ways of keeping federal officials and judges accountable under the written Constitution. They haven't often been resorted to, but they are there.
I want to just add that if to go back to the idea of how does government secure our rights, from the point of view of the founders, if you think about it just in terms of domestic policy, none of the branches of government is the most important branch, because you need them all. I mean, the legislative is the most important in the sense that they make the rules we have to live by. But those rules wouldn't work. They wouldn't be effective without a judiciary to put people on trial and to allow people to sue each other and decide, you know, who has actually committed the injury, who hasn't paid the contract, and an executive to make sure that people pay their fines, go to jail, or whatever it happens to be. You need all of them. The whole point of the system is you protect rights by having laws that say you can't do certain things, and then making sure they get punished, making sure you get the deterrent effect. You know, that requires all three branches to do their proper job. And the role of the judiciary, it's part of that. It's subordinate in the sense that it's, you know, behind, under the laws. But it's independent in the sense that they're not supposed to be swayed by the opinion of the legislature about the outcome of a particular trial or a particular case.
Next question. In the back of the room.
I want to just thank Hillsdale for sponsoring this morning. It's a very interesting and challenging discussion we've had. I'd like to refer back to the preamble to the Constitution and its 8 goals and make an observation and then ask a question. The observation would be, as the role of government is transitioned from the goals of that preamble, of more towards the welfare and away from issues that the general interest can all agree to, like providing for the common defense, the general acceptability, the credibility of the federal government has gone down today to such an extent that it's less now, I guess, than 15% of American people will trust the Congress to do the right thing most of the time. It's embarrassing and over the long term can have a real impact on the ability of the federal government to even govern. I liken that to the idea of the paradox of trust. More people trust their own congressman and their own senator than they do Congress. And that's because as the functions have moved towards welfare, we rob Peter to pay Paul in the sense that we take away from some people in order to benefit others. The final observation I make that leads to the question is that with respect to the blessings of liberty, we've gone one step too far, I think, and that's the question I have. The blessings of liberty are achieved through a separation or a limitation on the role of government intrusion into our lives. And one aspect of that is taxes. And I've seen that we're now in a situation that, because every economist would agree that the yawning gap between the cost of government and the revenue of government, which all people have, well, the latest analysis was that we're going to have to cut that gap by 8% of GNP over the next 30 years in order to balance our budget, has resulted in a government debt situation where we're passing more and more and more cost of our own benefit, of our own prosperity, on to my 7 grandchildren, 3 of which have been adopted to China and may well go back, because of the tax rates that they're going to have to pay in order to pay for my life expectancy, my life. I'd also want, so how do you all come to this issue of the advocation, I'd say, of responsibility on the part of the executive who've said that in order to control government spending, they'd cut taxes and therefore stop feeding the beast? It's almost like,
But the basic problem is that we don't have enough, we don't have a consensus yet in the country with respect to all of the programs that this money is funding. If we had that consensus, the problem of taxation could take care of itself. If you had people say, you know, we really don't, we need to move away from the idea that federal government and state government has to deal with all of the everyday problems of our lives, putting lights in hallways, giving, you know, mandating shots for kids. This is expensive stuff. Providing for the health care of the nation. I mean, from the founders, they would have said, look, if you're poor, if you're destitute, yes, government will come, if you don't have a family to help you, government will step in and give you the minimum. But we're not going to give you the state of the art of anything, health care, housing, food, TVs, flat screen TVs, air conditioning, institutional right. cooking, you know, that kind of thing. They were big on that. Now, if you have that attitude, then people who have the money to provide for their own health care will pay for it, and they won't complain about it because the expectation will be there. But the way we are now, we're all used to the idea, well, every government needs to pay for all that for us. And why? We've just gotten into the habit. I mean, I do think that the current fiscal crisis, which you pointed to rightly, is having a good effect in the sense that it makes it clear you cannot have it all. You can't have a thriving economy consistent with the kind of welfare state that we've gotten ourselves into. And there's a choice that has to be made. It's one of the things that you can see that's healthy about our current debate in the presidential campaign and in Congress. Congressman Ryan's, that's his whole thing, right? I mean, you can't keep going. It's not going to work. We're going to have a financial collapse. Or we're going to have to change these policies. So that the necessity to confront that, which is happening here and in Europe, I think is a very healthy development.
Dr. Marino? I think the attitude or the hope, the strategy that you could starve the beast just doesn't work, hasn't worked. I mean, then there are a number of conservatives who have embraced that. They're attempted to practice it, but it hasn't been effective. The beast, you know, keeps growing. One thing that I think was insufficiently noticed, it's rarely mentioned about the early part of the century and the Bush administration. You know, the Bush administration, President Bush is often blamed, now blamed by liberals for the tax cuts. It's often overlooked that one of the intelligence failures of the era is, you know, it's not just weapons of mass destruction in Iraq, but financial projections. The notion that we had huge surpluses turned out to be wrong. It was just a bad estimate on the part of the estimators.
I think we have time for one more question.
This last question comes from our online viewers. Marcus asks, much has been made of nullification and Article 5 conventions. I'm not sold yet. That seems to promote anarchy. But are they constitutional solutions to our political problems?
Are there constitutional solutions to our political problems?
Is nullification a constitutional solution?
No. Nullification is not. I
thought the question was about Article 5 constitutional conventions. Is that right?
I heard nullification.
Okay, sorry.
I heard both.
All right.
So we'll let you answer both.
Go ahead, Paul.
No to nullification, and yes to the processes that are laid out in Article 5, which include, you know, state legislative initiation of the constitutional amending procedure. So again, as Congressman Ryan pointed out, the means are there in the Constitution, and the means don't even always have to be exercised. We got pretty close to the threshold for a balanced budget amendment in the 1980s, and that got Congress's attention, and they actually enacted some deficit reducing legislation. So sometimes a threat is enough.
Dr. West?
Yeah, I would add, in terms of the suggestion that perhaps we should have a constitutional convention to fix some of these problems. From my point of view, that's even more dangerous than what we're already doing, because think of who would get elected to that convention. I mean, we would be electing the kinds of people who are in our ruling class today who are basically comfortable with the modern state. And then potentially undermine the one thing we've still got that resists the trend, namely the Constitution itself.
Well said. I think I began by noting that there is a political constraint on all of this. One of the questions dealt with the issue of repealing the Federal Department of Education. I mentioned that I was elected as a part of the class of 1994, and you will recall, I believe, that we pledged to repeal the Federal Department of Education, and then once here, failed to do so. It's been a little difficult for me not to comment on each of these points, but I think one of the things that's interesting to note about federalism is that one would think, since many federal legislators, members of the United States Congress, come from state legislatures, that they would arrive and jealously guard the territory where they had learned their skills back at the state legislature. And yet, I think it's an interesting combination of seduction by the power of Washington, absolute power corrupt, power corrupts absolutely, that they don't do that. My class, as I noted earlier, came here to change Washington, and in the end, it was changed by Washington. That would suggest to me that, I think has been said by several of our speakers, as the American people's appetite for freedom goes, so goes federalism, which means it's all up to us. And I think you are all here participating in an important discussion, but recognizing that there's work ahead of us to do as some of the panelists have suggested, and to reassert the proper role of government as a limited one, and the primacy of us as individuals and of the states as well. I'd like you to thank all of the members of the panel one more time.